talk about the non-idealities in MOS capacitor. Non-ideality in MOS capacitor. And we will see what will be the impact of these non-idealities in terms of its performance. Okay. So first actually we'll consider that the phi m, the metal work function, is not equal to semiconductor work function. Q time phi m is different than Q time phi s. So in an ideal MOS capacitor, we consider that phi m was equal to phi s. It means both metal and semiconductors and both materials were actually same. Okay. But in this case, we are considering that metal and semiconductor work functions are different. So metal here, oxide, semiconductor. Okay. So their work functions are different. And for the time being, let us consider that the phi m is greater than phi s. And the semiconductor is p-type. Okay. So we'll always consider it p-type until it is informed to you. So in p-type semiconductor oxide, and on the top there is a metal, and our consideration is this: the metal work function is greater than semiconductor work function. Okay, so what will happen when phi m was equal to phi s? Then there was flat band. If you recall, the bands were flat because there were no charges in the system. Okay, there is no electric field. Until we didn't apply the potential between anode and cathode terminals, there were no charges in the system and the bands were flat. Okay, but is that also true for this case? If phi m is greater than phi s or less than phi s, that we are going to investigate. Okay. So just consider an hypothetical situation that the metal terminal is shorted with the body terminal. Okay, the gate terminal, the gate terminal is shorted with the body terminal. Okay. And now this phi m is greater than phi s. Okay. It means if I consider vacuum level here, so the metal work function is Q time phi m. This is Q time phi m, and this is greater than Q time phi s, this difference. Okay, and now I'm sorting this gate and semiconductor. So you know that their Fermi levels are different. Okay, so there will be tendency of carrier movement, maybe from the metal to semiconductor or semiconductor to metal, through this hypothetical interconnect that is placed between the gate terminal and the body terminal. Okay, so as you can see, the semiconductor Fermi level is greater than that of the metal Fermi level for this given condition. The electrons will be moving from semiconductor to metal. Okay. That will leave this semiconductor positively charged and the metal terminal being the negatively charged. Okay. It means some positive charges will be developed in the semiconductor and the equal amount of the negative charges will be developed in the metal terminal. Okay. And this is happening not because of the bias voltage that is applied between the gate and body terminal. It is happening because of the metal semiconductor work function difference. You know that when there are two materials with different work function, there will be because of that work function difference, there will be a built-in potential in between. So you can think as if it's a kind of built-in potential that is developed here. Okay, and this hypothetical interconnect is just used here so that to give you a feel that if there is any charge movement or how these charges are actually developed here. Okay, because as the if the gate is left open and gate and body terminals are left open, then it will be hard to actually visualize these things. I mean, how the potential will be developed. But of course, it's the only concept just to explain the things. These things are being considered. Okay, so from this actually, here actually, because I mentioned that the semiconductor, the carriers were moving from semiconductor to metal. Okay, because the semiconductor is at the work function of semiconductor is higher than that of the metal. So they are expected to move, and how they will move? They will move, may move through this wire. So that's why this hypothetical wire is connected. Okay, in practice, these things are not required. These are just concept, and it will be used to explain the certain behavior of this MOS capacitor only. Okay. So what did you see? That in presence of if because of this metal semiconductor work function difference, now there is a charge in the system, and the metal plate is negatively charged, semiconductor is positively charged. Okay. Now let us say that I wish to. So because of these charges, now there will be field line like this, and if there is an electric field, there will be band bending seen in the semiconductor in the oxide region as well. Both in the semiconductor and oxide, there will be band bending, and you can actually think in which direction this is going to bend, inward or upward. Okay, it hardly matters because we have considered one case here, phi m less than phi s, phi m greater than phi s. Another case could be phi s less than phi m. What the point I want to make here is this, that because of this metal semiconductor work function difference, there may be electric field, there will be band bending, charges will be there in the system. Okay, now I want to remove these charges, then what should I do? Removing charges is equivalent to making the bands flat. Okay, so what should I do? What will you suggest if I have to remove these charges?
Sir, bias.
Yes, very good. I can connect a battery here. Okay, and if this battery is able to, and this should be the polarity of this battery, because there are some negative charges in the metal in certain amount. If I could provide positive charges in the same amount, the charges will be vanished from the system. So I will connect a battery, and the battery potential would be phi ms. Okay, so which is equal to phi m minus phi s. So if I connect a battery with the battery with this potential phi ms, okay, such that this phi ms is equal to phi m minus phi s, then these charges will be vanished. Okay, these charges will be disappeared from the system, and your MOS capacitor is going to look like this. So even though there is a work function difference in metal and semiconductor, but if I connect a battery here with the battery potential phi ms, there will be no charge in the system, and therefore the bands will remain flat. Okay, so that EC, EB and your EF and EI all will flat. Okay, and these are actually this is in x direction, and x is here in this direction in the semiconductor. Okay, so we can make the bands flat by using this external potential. Okay, so this was one of the non-linearity where we considered non-equal metal semiconductor work function. Okay, and in practical cases, this is always going to happen. Okay, that metals will have definitely some different work function than the semiconductor. So always, if you want to make band flats, then you need to apply some additional potential between the anode and cathode terminal, or between the gate and body terminal. And what will be the polarity of this phi ms? That depends upon the respective values of phi m and phi s. If phi m is greater than phi s, you need a positive voltage here as a phi ms. But if phi s is less than phi m, then you may need a negative voltage. So negative voltage will do the same thing, that will actually make all charges disappear from the system. Okay, so this was one of the non-linearity and non-ideality, and that non-ideality is tackled in this particular way. Okay, then there could be another non-ideality, that is the presence of oxide charges. Okay, presence of oxide charges. So in oxide region there could be some charge particles, charged particles. Okay, that may be because of the various region. What could be those region? One of the region is the incomplete oxidation, because to grow this oxide region, silicon dioxide over silicon, what I need to do, I need to oxidize this silicon, and this oxidation happens in a furnace. So when this oxidation process is going on, during the process the oxygen atoms are making bond with silicon to form silicon dioxide. But when you stop this oxidation process, you have to stop it at certain point of the time, because you are looking for a certain oxide thickness here and you got it. So once you got it, then you will stop this process. So when this process is stopped, so it is very likely that some of the silicon dioxide bonds are incomplete, and those incomplete bonds give rise to some positive charges in this oxide region. Okay, so this could be because of incomplete oxidation. Incomplete oxidation. Another region could be the interface traps at the interface. So you know the traps can capture electrons. Okay, those traps become positively or negatively charged. So there could be trap at the interfaces. Trap at interfaces. Okay, these traps can contribute to the oxide charges. The third one could be the human being itself. Okay, if you are processing this device, okay, if you are touching this device, you know that the human body, we are the source of, this sodium and potassium ion, there will be a lot of, because of the sweating, sodium potassium ions are always there in at our hand. So when we touch this device bare hand, we'll transfer some of those charges to the oxide during the oxidation process. So those charges may present here, and those charges are very dangerous because they are mobile charges. They can move in the oxide region at the various they can be found anywhere in this silicon dioxide region, in the dielectric. Okay, so there could be the third category of the charges are mobile sodium and potassium ion. Okay, mobile sodium potassium ions. Okay, so and there may be some other charges because of the radiation. If device is being operated under the radiative environment, okay, then the oxide region can trap some charges, and so there could be a variety of the charges, there are different sources of the charges, and the charge natures may be different, positive charge or negative charges. But to model a device, what is done, it is considered that a fixed amount of the positive charges are present in the oxide region, and that is very close to the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Okay, slightly above this silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Okay, and of course these charges are being considered as a positive charges. So whether the device is p-type semiconductor or n-type semiconductor, the interface charges, the oxide charges, are always considered to be positive charges. Okay, so let us say that the charge density is q naught prime, okay, which is q naught upon a is the cross section area in the z direction, which is not shown actually. So this is a, the area of this plane in z direction is A actually. Okay. So Q naught prime is the oxide charges. Okay. And now if there are oxide charges in the system, then what will happen? And these charges are positive. And let us say that there were non-zero phi ms, there was non-zero phi ms, and the bands were made flat by applying some potential phi ms, okay, between the gate and body terminal. So phi ms is already applied, okay. Phi ms is already applied to make the bands flat, but now because of the oxide charges, there are oxide charges in the semiconductor. So there will be some negative charges induced in the metal and some charges may be induced in the semiconductor, because these positive charges have to be balanced by the negative charges. Okay, so some charges are induced in the metal, some charges are induced in the semiconductor, but we want to make the semiconductor the bands flat in the semiconductor. And what we have to do, we have to actually remove these charges from the semiconductor. Okay, so what should I do to remove the charges from the semiconductor? Any suggestion?
Additional voltage.
Additional voltage. And what will be the polarity of that voltage? Same as high MS or in different manner?
Well, different.
Different. Great. So why it is so? Because now I would like to supply the Q prime charges to this metal plate. Okay. So if that amount of the charges are present, then all these positive charges will be balanced. Okay. Same negative charges, if the negative charges are induced in the metal, the concentration of these charges are same as that of that are present in the oxide region, then these charges will vanish immediately. Okay, and now this bands become flat. And what should be this what should be the magnitude of this voltage? Can you predict it? You already know that the capacitance of this oxide is Cox. Okay, Cox is epsilon Ox upon Tox, or epsilon Ox upon D. Whatever notation you take, D as a thickness of the oxide region, or Cox as a, or Tox as a thickness of the oxide. Okay, so the capacitance, oxide capacitance per unit area, turns out to be epsilon Ox upon D or epsilon Ox upon Tox. So let us say this is known to you. Q naught is also known to you, Q naught prime. Okay, so what will be the potential here that I supply?
2/3 O/Cox.
Fantastic. Okay. Or Qo prime upon Cox. Okay. So this is the total now, because of these non-idealities, the total additional potential which is required is phi ms minus Q prime upon Cox. So this much of additional potential is required to make the bands flat. So we call this potential as a flat band voltage, VFB. Okay, flat band voltage. This is a very, very important parameter. Let me write it, the flat band voltage. This is equal to phi ms minus Q prime upon Cox. Okay. And it is referred as VFB. All right. It means that this amount of this much voltage will actually drop in the to make the bands flat. Means if you don't know that there are non-idealities in the system, okay, and you apply a voltage VG at the gate terminal. VG at the gate terminal, here let us say VG is applied, This is now grounded. Potential drop across the arc side is Vox. Let us say that the surface potential was equal to psi s. Okay. So Vg now becomes Vg equal to Vox plus psi s plus Vfb. Because now a fraction of this Vg is also utilized to make the bands flat. That is Vfb. So the modified potential balance equation under because of these non-idealities is no more Vg equal to Vox or Vo plus psi s. It has now become Vg equal to Vfb, which is phi ms minus q naught upon Cox, okay, plus Vox plus psi s. Okay, and therefore you will see that the threshold voltage also gets modified. Okay, so the Vt, can you help me to write down the threshold voltage expression that we derived in the previous class? Vt was equal to twice psi b plus, what was that? 2q epsilon s Na upon Cox prime. Am I right? We derived the threshold voltage expression in the previous class. Okay. Maybe you have forgotten that. Let me show you the slide. So I was actually talking about this expression, the threshold voltage expression, which was Vt equal to V naught plus 2 psi b, which is 2 psi b plus 2 epsilon s qna 2 psi b upon Cox. Okay, so that's why I have taken 2 out from the square root here. Okay, this 2 should be taken out. So the threshold voltage of the MOS capacitor was equal to Vt twice psi b plus 2q epsilon s Na, it was 2 psi b, probably psi b, okay, upon Cox. So this was the threshold voltage expression when the flat band voltage was 0 in ideal MOS capacitor case. Okay. Why I call it Vfb equal to 0? Because phi ms was 0 and we also considered that the Q prime is also 0, no oxide charges. Okay, so Vfb was 0. But now in this case, the charge balance equation gets modified, potential balance equation gets modified like this: Vg equal to Vfb plus this Vox plus Is. So now we will have another term in this expression. So the threshold voltage of a non-ideal MOS capacitor turns out to be this. Okay. The non-idealities is actually captured through this term, which is Vfb, called the flat band voltage. Okay. Any question, any doubt from anybody?
Sir, can you go to that capacitor part, the value of capacitor that you wrote above, in this only?
Here?
No, on that page only you wrote now.
Yes.
On your...
Oh, sorry, Na is missing actually. So you make it correct, okay. It was 2q epsilon s Na into psi b. Okay, I made a mistake, but you can make it correct. So I just wanted to point out that now one additional term Vfb will also come here for the threshold voltage, which is Vt equal to twice psi b plus Vfb plus this term because of the depletion charges. Okay. Any other question from anybody till now? Okay, is it fine to everybody? Okay, so now we'll actually discuss a little bit about the MOSFET. Okay, and the reason we are discussing about the MOS capacitor because we wanted to understand the working principle of a MOSFET. Okay. And we are considering here a N MOSFET like the NPN and PNP transistors, BJT transistors. There will be two versions of the MOSFET. One is N MOSFET, and another one is the P MOSFET. So first we'll talk about the N MOSFET. So for a N MOSFET, we take to P type substrate. Okay, so substrate is P type, and in P type substrate, the two regions, source and drain regions, are created, N plus and N plus. Okay, and then this region between the source and drain is oxidized. So we first create silicon dioxide, and on the top we deposit a metal. So this becomes the gate terminal because this is metal oxide and P type semiconductor. Okay, and this is N plus region. So we also deposit metal here to get another terminal, which is called source, and some metal will also be deposited here to get the another terminal, which is called drain. Okay, so body
your,
terminal.
Sir, your slide is stuck.
Pardon? Can you not see this?
Yeah. Sir, it is stuck to the whiteboard part.
But I am actually making this picture on whiteboard only.
Sir, but we aren't able to see that picture.
Sir, it's clear.
Pardon?
It's working. Check your connection, Aman.
Yeah, okay. So okay. This terminal is actually body terminal. Okay. So in MOSFET there could be four terminals: source, gate, drain, and body. Okay. Sometime we keep body to the ground. So the MOS transistor that you are going to use in your lab to perform the experiment, that will probably have three terminals only: source, gate, and drain. The body is actually body. Terminal access is not there. Okay, body is however useful terminal sometime to alter the characteristics of the device, but let us say that for the time being here the body is not present, so there are only three terminals: source, gate, and drain. Okay, and now we understand the working of this MOS capacitor, metal oxide and semiconductor. So in a MOS transistor, generally you will see the source terminal will be kept at low potential. It is if it is a N MOS device. Okay, please just concentrate here. For a MOSFET, if it is N MOSFET, we take P substrate. So between source and drain, this region, this terminal is source terminal. But this region is also called source region, and this is called the drain region. Okay, these are almost symmetrical structure, source and drain. Okay, the picture is not very good quality. However, you just consider these two are symmetrical. So either of these can be taken as a source and drain. Okay, theoretically. All right. So to operate it, the source terminal can be connected to ground here. So this terminal is ground, and a potential will be applied here between drain to source, at the drain terminal, VD. So there is a drain to source potential, VDS. Okay, let us say it VDS. So there is a source to drain potential, which is VDS. VDS minus zero, which is VDS. But if I keep this VG open, nothing will happen. I will not see any current actually in the drain terminal. Okay, no current will be seen in this branch. Okay, just to make it more meaningful, I will connect a battery here so that you will feel that the loop is complete. Okay, so there won't be any current actually. Because why there won't be any current? because we have a P substrate. So there is a N plus P junction here, and then there is a P N plus junction. N plus P junction and P N plus junction. There are two PN junctions. And this one, the second PN junction, N plus P, you see that the N terminal of this PN junction is at high voltage, VDS. VDS is high, large. So this PN junction is under reverse bias condition, okay? And this PN junction may be in forward bias, but if the two PN junction diodes are connected back to back, if one is connected in this fashion and another one is connected in this fashion, okay? And if you keep a high potential here, if you keep a high potential, I made a mistake actually. There are two PN junction, one is like this, the NP, okay, then PN, like this. This is grounded, this is connected to VDS, okay. So because of this VDS, VDS will drive this in reverse bias. Let's say it is D1 and this is D2. So this VDS will drive this in reverse bias. This may be in the forward bias because some positive fraction of VDS may appear here. Okay, but since the two diodes are connected in this fashion, only one current can flow, and this current will be definitely determined by the leakage current of this PN junction, the reverse saturation current of this PN junction diode D2. Because this PN junction, because in a branch only one current can flow. Okay, so although this diode D1 has an ability to conduct a larger current, but a large current won't flow because this D2 is under reverse bias. Okay, so this is N plus P and N plus, and this N plus P junction is under reverse bias, so no current will flow. So the through this branch, and you will see here the current will be, although it will be there, but it will be very small. That is a reverse current of this PN junction diode. Okay. So the current here, let us say, is flowing in this direction, and it is noted as ID because it is associated with the drain terminal, is equal to zero. Okay. All right. Now, what should I do to force a current through this branch? You already know the behavior of this MOS capacitor, okay, metal oxide and semiconductor. And why there is no current? Because there is a no channel. This is N plus region. So a lot of electrons are there in this region, and a lot of electrons are also present in this region, drain region. But here there are deficit of electrons. There are very few electrons in this region, in the substrate region. Okay, so because of that only there is no, the path of current is, having very large resistance, and due to that large resistance, there will be only a very, very small current. If I want to make this happen, if I want to set up a current ID here, what should I do? How can I make a current? How can I get a finite current here? What could be the solution?
VG very, very greater than zero.
Right. What should I do to VG? I should increase it. Okay. And what should be its value? VG should be? You answered correctly. Can you just repeat? VG should be greater than equal to VT. What was VT? VTH. The VTH was the threshold voltage. When there is a threshold, VG is equal to VTH, then the P type turns into N type. Is it or not? When VG is equal to VT, this semiconductor goes in strong inversion, and the electron will appear here, and the electron concentration is quite large. So if I connect VG here, and the VG is made sure that VG is greater than equal to VTH, then there will be plenty of electrons present here between below this surface, below the silicon-silicon dioxide interface. Now this is N plus source, N plus drain, and in between there is a N-type region, N channel. So there is a now N region throughout from the source to drain. Source N plus, this is now N plus, this is again N plus. So we have a very, very highly conductive path for the current flow. And now this terminal is at positive potential VDS, okay? Then this terminal, so there is a potential difference as well in this channel. And this potential difference will make sure that the carriers will move from the source to drain in this direction. Carrier will start moving from source to drain, okay, in this channel. And when the carriers will be moving from source to drain, there will be current in the opposite direction, IDS, ID, okay, and the same ID will also be seen in this branch. So now the ID becomes finite, okay. This is the working principle of a MOSFET actually. When you apply VG above VTH, there will be channel between the two source and drain region, and there will be a current flow, and the current can be varied, current can be controlled by changing this VDS and the VGS. The gate source, because source is grounded, so we can call this potential between this terminal and this terminal as a VGS, and the potential between the drain terminal and the source terminal is VDS. So by changing this VDS and VGS, I can change the current ID. ID is in fact given as a mu COX W by L, okay, half into 2 VGS minus VTH into VDS minus VDS square by 2. Okay, so I will not go into the detail of the derivation, okay, although I would love to do that because there is a time limitations. There are so many things I wanted to discuss here, but there could be a current relation here between the current and voltage, okay, and there is a different region of operation as well. If VDS is small, okay, if VDS is less than VGS minus VTH, okay, we call the transistor is in the linear region of the operation, linear region of the operation. If VDS is greater than VGS minus VTH, and at the same time we ensure that the VDS is greater than the VGS is greater than VTH, the transistor enters into the saturation region. Okay, when VDS is less than VGS minus VTH and VGS greater than VTH, we call the transistor is in the linear region of the operation. Okay, linear, here it is saturation. Okay, linear and saturation. And there is another region of the operation which is the off cutoff condition or off condition. And it is very easy to guess, if I will keep VGS less than VTH, okay, there will not be a channel between source and drain region, and even if the large VDS is applied, there will be negligible current flowing, okay. So we call the transistor in the off condition if VGS get to source voltage is less than VTH, okay. So I will also urge you that you go through this equation. Maybe it may be incorrect, okay, some place maybe half is missing or some additional half has come here, but you can refer to the book and you can get a relation between the current and the voltages, ID current, voltages are VGS and VDS, okay, and by varying VDS and VGS we can have a current, okay, we can vary the current. And the if you'd like to see how the current will vary with VGS and VTH, you can see here the MOSFET. Can you see this picture? So here ID is varied with VDS for the different value of VGS. Okay. So VGS is, you can see initially when VDS is increased, ID increases linearly, and then at the large value of VDS, ID gets saturated. Okay. This curve is actually plotted from that equation only. Okay. So at low VDS, the ID changes almost linearly with VDS. So we call this region of as a linear region of the operation because the VDS is small. And you can also see this dotted line. So this line is a boundary between the linear region and saturation region. And this line is referring VDS equal to VGS minus VT. So this is actually indicating the onset of saturation. When VDS is slightly greater than this VGS minus VT, the characteristics is in this region. So the saturation region of the MOSFET is like the active region of BJT. Getting it or not? In BJT, we had the saturation region here. Okay. But here we have linear region. Okay. So the MOSFET saturation region is equivalent to the MOSFET saturation region is equivalent to the active region of the BJT, and the linear region of this may be equivalent to the, not exactly, but if you just comparing the characteristics, then it will be like that of the saturation region of the BJT. So don't get confused. Okay. Why we call it saturation region? Because the current is now saturated. You can see the current is no more changing with VDS. Current is almost constant. And if the current is constant, we can see this transistor as a current source. Okay, you can use this to design the current source because it can deliver a constant current even if the voltage is changing. So that is the characteristics of a current source. So and its output resistance is going to be very high. Okay, so saturation region, if VGS is changed, VGS is increased, then the current increases because there will be more and more strong channel formed between source and drain. Number of electrons will increase, so definitely the current level will increase. So with VGS, current will increase. Okay, and this linear region, the characteristics is almost similar to that of a resistor, because in a resistor, when you change VDS, ID will linearly increase with VDS. So the linear region is also called the resistive region sometime, okay, because its characteristics is similar to the resistor. And in integrated circuits, sometime you actually need the resistors to realize a block. So there actually you can use even the MOS transistor as a resistor, because when you are going for the fabrication technology, okay, when you are going to fabricate so many MOSFETs on a chip at the same time, so it is easier to fabricate a MOSFET compared to a discrete resistor. So why not to use the MOSFET as a resistor? So when MOSFET is biased in the linear region, it can be acted as a resistor, it can act as a resistor. Okay, so this is actually the output characteristics of BJT. Similarly, MOSFET, similarly, we can also have the input characteristics or IDVG characteristics, okay, of a MOSFET, ID versus VGS, okay. And if I take the log of here, log of ID, then its characteristics is going to be like this. Okay, if you plot it on the linear scale, then it will look like this, ID, VG. So there the characteristics is going to look like this. This is VTH. So when VGS is above VTH, then only the current will be significant. If VGS is less than VTH, the current is going to be small. So VTH is a very, very important parameter, particularly when you use the transistor as a switch. Okay. Switches are very important component of a digital circuits. Okay, most of the digital circuits are realized using switches. BJT can, and even the MOSFET can be used as a switch. So when you use as a switch, MOSFET as a switch, then you must know what is the switching voltage. And you need to have a very precise control over the switching voltage, because your circuit design will be based on that. Okay, so that's why this VTH, the threshold voltage, is a very, very important parameter of a MOSFET. Okay, and as you can see that for a N-channel MOSFET, it is going to be positive. It will be a positive value, maybe 0.2, 0.4, 0.8, okay, 1.2, depending upon the physical dimensions of the device and the doping level of the device. Okay, and the MOSFET structure that we considered here was like this. Okay, we had this P substrate, and in the P substrate, N plus regions were created. Okay, and we had the terminals like gate, source, and the drain. So an alternative of this is also possible, where we will have N substrate, and in N substrate the P plus region, P plus source and drain can be created. P plus means the higher, a P region with high doping, and then there is a gate oxide and the metal. So the gate terminal here, and the source and the body terminal. Okay, so this is called P-MOSFET. In P-MOSFET, the substrate is N-type. In N-MOSFET, this is N-MOSFET. In N-MOSFET, the substrate is P-type. So please
sir, keep it is body terminal or the drain terminal there.
Pardon? Can you repeat your question once again?
In that P-MOSFET, in the P plus side, it is body terminal or inside?
Sorry. This is drain actually, not body. It was a mistake. Okay. Drain I am actually neglecting in all the devices. However, there could be even body I am neglecting, body terminals. There could be body in even N-MOSFET as well as in P-MOSFET. Okay, but I am neglecting this. So there are two variants, P-MOSFET and N-MOSFET, N-MOSFET and P-MOSFET. Okay, and you can see that the channel was absent. Either it is this N-MOSFET or this P-MOSFET. So in this P-MOSFET actually, you need to apply a negative gate voltage here to create holes in between the two source regions, source and drain. Okay. Here actually you need a positive gate voltage to apply a positive gate voltage at the gate terminal to create electrons in the P region to invert this. Here a negative gate voltage will invert this N2 region to P region. Here a positive gate voltage will invert this P region to N region. Okay. So the threshold voltage of a N MOSFET is actually positive, where the threshold voltage of a P MOSFET is actually negative. Okay. And since the channel is not permanently there, okay, you see the channel will be created between source and drain in N MOSFET or P MOSFET depending upon the application of the gate voltage. When gate voltage here is greater than VTH N, or the gate voltage here is less than minus VTHP, then only the channel will be created. So that's why these devices are known as enhancement type devices. Okay, enhancement type devices. Why it is so? Because the channel has to be enhanced by applying a suitable gate potential. Okay, so that's why these are enhancement type devices. And because of this, so there are two more variations of the MOS transistor. Okay, those are actually the depletion type MOSFETs. These were enhancement type MOSFETs, where the channel were to be created, but there could be a depletion type MOSFET depletion MOSFET, where the channel will be permanently there. Okay, for example, if I have to build a n-channel depletion MOSFET, n-channel MOSFET, which is a depletion mode MOSFET, then its structure is going to be like this. Maybe I can start with p-type substrate in this case as well, as it was in the previous case. Okay, I will create n plus source and drain regions, then the gate and metal contacts are similar, gate, source and the drain, these are actually similar to the previous structure, but there is a permanent channel present here. Some portion of this p-type will be converted to n-type by the doping, okay, by the impurity doping before the deposition of this silicon dioxide or gate oxide and putting metal on that. What I will do, I will diffuse some n-type impurities. So this was n plus created, and in between I will create a n region forcefully, by because you know that p region can be converted into n region. If you diffuse n-type impurity like phosphorus, arsenic or antimony, you can convert p region to n region. So the impurities are diffused here to make a permanent channel. So this device, however, is permanently on. Okay, even if your gate voltage, gate to source voltage is zero, if let's say source is grounded here and gate to source voltage is zero, gate is let's say also grounded, then you apply a VD here, you can see a current even if the gate voltage is zero, because the channel is already there, it will act as a n region n plus, so VD, so conductive region is there, and if you create a potential difference, it's like a semiconductor material where you create a potential difference, you will see a current. When you vary VD, the current will vary. So this is a permanently on device. However, to make this device off, what should I do? I should apply a negative gate voltage here to deplete this channel. As you saw that since the p-type region can be converted to n-type region by applying a gate potential. So similarly, n-type region by applying a negative gate potential can also be depleted. Okay, it can be converted into p-type material. So if I apply a large negative potential here, this n-type can be converted to p-type. The whole region can become p-type. Okay, and then only this device will be in off condition. Okay, so the threshold voltage of this is actually negative. Although it's n-channel device, but its threshold voltage is negative, because to make it off, to break the channel, I need a negative gate voltage here, unlike the previous case. Okay, because the previous device was normally off. This is normally on device. Normally on device. Okay, so to make it off, actually you need to apply gate voltage. Previous one was normally off. To make that on, you need a gate voltage. Okay, and a P version of this depletion MOSFET can also be seen, where this will be replaced by P plus region, this will be replaced by P plus region, and this may be N type, and in between there will be P type channel can be created. Okay, so MOSFETs could be, just I would like to summarize here, an enhancement mode MOSFET, the enhancement MOSFET could be n-type, n-MOSFET, or it could be a p-MOSFET. So enhancement MOSFETs are normally off device. They are normally off device. Okay, to make these on, you need VG greater than VTH. In this case, VTHN I am writing because I am referring to N MOSFET, and here you need VG less than minus VTHP. Okay, then there will be a depletion type MOSFETs. So this is normally on. So if it is normally on, then I will have to make it off. And it has two version, N MOSFET, where N type channel is permanently there, and the P MOSFET, where P type channel is permanently there. And source and drain are also P type. The source and drain are N type in this case. Source and drain will be P type in this case. And to make this off, actually, you need a negative voltage. So its VTH is negative actually. Okay, and to make this off, you need a positive voltage. So its VTH is actually positive. VTH is positive, VTH negative, and VTH is also positive here. And here VTH is negative. Okay. So with this, I would actually like to finish this course. Okay. I wish I had few more lectures, but due to the time limit actually.